In Alaska, boating is a lifestyle. People rely on it for transportation. They depend on it for subsistence and enjoy it for recreation. It shouldn't be a surprise since Alaska has more water and more coastline than any other state in the country. With 3,000 rivers, 33,000 miles of coastline, and 3 million lakes. Unfortunately, Alaska also has one of the highest boating fatality rates in the nation. In the past 15 years, there were over 300 recreational boating deaths in Alaska, more than in commercial boating. Many of these deaths could have been prevented. Hey everybody, I'm Greg.
And I'm Katie. Well, there's always going to be some risk in boating. Safe and enjoyable boating is possible with effective risk management.
That's right. Risk management depends on four things: your attitude, skill and ability, good unimpaired judgment, as well as knowledge and experience.
Knowledge and experience are especially important because 8 out of 10 boating fatalities nationwide involve boating operators who've never had a single boating safety course.
To help manage these risks and ensure a safe, enjoyable time on the water, we're going to look at four areas: pre-trip preparation, things to know on the water, accident prevention, and emergency and accident response. Just remember, while this DVD gives you an excellent overview of boating, it's not a comprehensive boating course.
The State of Alaska Office of Boating Safety is another great place for additional information. The first thing we're going to discuss is pre-trip preparation, things you need to know and do before you get on the water. Good pre-trip preparation includes having all the legally required and recommended equipment, meeting other legal requirements, ensuring your boat is in good condition, checking the weather, and preparing a float plan.
Let's take a look at the legal requirements. The law requires that you carry certain types of equipment on your boat. These requirements vary depending upon the type of boat that you have. We're going to be looking at some of the most basic requirements that apply to the majority of powerboats. Always make sure that you check on the specific requirements for your particular boat. Boaters can expect to be contacted by state peace officers as they enforce legal requirements and other boating laws.
While boating on Alaska's cold waters, the single most important piece of equipment you can have on board, personal flotation device, also known as a PFD or life jacket. You're required by law to have at least one life jacket per person on board. Some boats also require you to have a throwable PFD. We'll talk more about life jackets in a minute.
In addition to life jackets, you'll also need to have the ability to produce an efficient sound signal, such as a whistle, a horn, or a bell. All boats are required to carry United States Coast Guard approved visual distress signals when boating at night or in limited visibility. There are many different types of approved signals, including orange flags, orange smoke, an SOS distress light, and flares. If you're carrying flares, remember to check the expiration date.
On most powerboats, fire extinguishers are another important piece of equipment often required. There are several different types of fire extinguishers, so be sure you have the right type and correct number of extinguishers for your boat. Also, be sure that your extinguisher is clearly marked U.S. Coast Guard approved or marine type.
All powerboats are required to have adequate ventilation, either natural or mechanical. And powerboats with an inboard gas motor are required to have a backfire flame arrestor on the carburetor.
Boats must be able to display navigation lights between sunset and sunrise, as well as during periods of restricted visibility. We'll discuss navigation lights in the On the Water section of this DVD.
Finally, if your boat is not documented with the United States Coast Guard, it must be registered with the Alaska DMV, display current registration numbers, a validation decal, and you must carry a boater registration certificate.
As we mentioned earlier, the most important piece of equipment you must have on board and should wear is a life jacket.
Each person on your boat is required to have a U.S. Coast Guard approved life jacket.
Boats that are 16 feet or longer, except for canoes and kayaks, are also required to have a U.S. Coast Guard approved Type 4 throwable device.
Each life jacket must fit properly, must be in good serviceable condition, and readily accessible.
Remember, children under 13 are required to wear their life jacket whenever they're in an open boat, on an open deck, or water skiing.
Hey, every experienced Alaskan boater knows it's a good idea to have your life jacket on at all times in the boat.
Exactly.
If you find yourself in the water, life jackets can assist with self-rescue, help with breathing, increase visibility, and may slow body heat loss. They will also keep you floating if you're injured, disabled, or even unconscious. Statistics show that 2 out of 3 people who died while boating in Alaska experienced a sudden capsize or fall overboard and weren't able to rescue themselves. And at least 8 out of the 10 who died weren't wearing a life jacket. Many of these people even considered themselves good swimmers.
The people most likely to die in a boating accident are adult males who are not wearing a life jacket, usually the vessel operator. Hunters and anglers are another high-risk group. Many times they don't think of themselves as boaters and may be unfamiliar with some boating risks.
Okay, now that we talked about why it's important to wear a life jacket, let's talk about two other important things: choosing and maintaining them. First, when choosing a life jacket, be sure to check the manufacturer's label to see if it's recommended for its intended use. Also, make sure it fits. And it's a good idea to test your life jacket in the water if possible.
Hey, with all the different types and styles of life jackets out there today, pick one you're comfortable with and wear it.
And once you have your life jacket, you're going to want to inspect it regularly.
Check the straps, zippers, and material. Look for rips or excessive wear. Always store them out of direct sunlight and keep them free from dirt and oils.
Because your life jacket can get damaged, don't use it for anything other than its intended use, wearing it.
Now let's talk about your boat. Did you know mechanical breakdown is the most common power boating problem? But these can easily be prevented with inspections and proper maintenance.
To keep your boat running smoothly, you should regularly inspect and maintain your electrical system, including your battery, spark plugs, wiring, and electrical connections.
Also, check your hull for stress cracks and leaks, and for the best performance and fuel economy, keep your hull free of marine growth.
It's a good idea to do a test run of all engines before every trip. On four-stroke engines, check your oil levels regularly and keep detailed maintenance and repair logs.
Finally, check your fuel system. Fuel contamination is a common problem when you're on the water. You can avoid this by properly filtering your fuel for water and debris.
Also, be sure to carry enough fuel. A good rule of thumb is one-third to get there, one-third to get back, and one-third in reserve.
Properly trailering and transporting your boat is another critical step in the pre-trip planning. Before towing your boat and trailer for the first time, match the tow ball with the trailer coupler and ensure a snug fit.
Then double chain your trailer to your vehicle using an X pattern with the hooks facing the trailer.
The boat should be tied down well and all loose gear should be secure. Also, make sure the trailer lights are connected and operational. And check the trailer tires, including the spare, for wear and proper inflation. And make sure your trailer is currently registered. And finally, before you leave, be sure to check overhead and side clearances. All right, we're almost ready to go.
Before leaving home, you should make sure that everything on your pre-departure checklist is completed. And since every boat and boater is different, develop a checklist that's specific to your boat and activities.
Some of the things you'll want to check include required equipment and other important items, such as tide tables, maps, appropriate clothing, food, and first aid kits. You'll also need to know who to contact and how to contact them in the event of an emergency. CB radios, cell phones, or satellite phones, as well as marine VHF radios, are a few of the ways you can stay in touch while on the water.
Last but not least, before departing, check the weather forecast. A float plan is one of the most important steps in your pre-trip preparation. It provides critical information to those who will assist you in an emergency. A float plan should include basic information, such as your destination and route, the number of people on board, the date and time you expect to return, a description of your vessel, a list of survival equipment on board, and when and who to contact if you're overdue.
Once completed, give your float plan to a reliable person. And when you get back, let them know you're okay.
Now, let's get on the water.